Zoning Board of Appeals of the Town of Deerfield will hold a public hearing on September 15th at 7 p.m. in room 107 of the town offices, located at 8 Conway Street in South Deerfield, Mass., on the application of Selco Partnership, doing business as Ryan Wireless, for a special permit and/or variance to reconstruct existing non-conforming structural deficient lattice-style communication tower on site with a new modern monopole tower, 25 feet taller in height, in the exact same location pursuant to the plans provided, supporting materials and statements in support which are incorporated into and made part of the application package. It was available for viewing in the Select Board's office last Friday, 9 to 4, whatever. So, and the location of the tower is at 84 Greenfield Road, South Deerfield, Mass., also known as the South Deerfield Fire Station under the Fire District. So, with that, my name is Ron Bahano, I'm our chair. I have Linda Dumas as a member, Robert Decker, who's a member, Chris Bissett, a member, Jamie.
Hartwright,
I'm sorry. As a member, and Ben Wadman as a member and slash clerk. So with that, what we'll do is we'll hear what the petitioner has to say, then we'll ask for people that don't want to speak in favor of it, and then we'll ask people that are opposed to it. We'll deliberate, we'll come to a decision, and then we'll move from there. So, and if you would, just please state your name so that it's easy for the clerk to keep track of it. So whoever would like to start first, that would be wonderful.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. My name is Carl Gehring on behalf of Verizon Wireless. I'm joined this evening joined by Elizabeth Jameson, representing Verizon Wireless, the real estate department. Next to her is Doug Roberts, professional engineer who prepared the plans, RF engineer, radio frequency engineer, Jay Latore, Dr. Don Hayes, certified health physicist, Doug Shadell, acoustical expert, and our landlord, Mr. Kevin Scarborough, I see sitting in the back. He's the gentleman that knocks on our door if we forget to pay the rent on time. Now, I introduce all these folks because this is a team effort. I see that you have the application binders in front of you, but all of these experts contributed to the contents of this application, so I wanted to introduce the fact that they're present at the site tonight. I'm going to go through it. I'm going to try to answer all your questions. However, if I'm not able to and you want to get in depth, then the experts are available. It also is a testament to the fact that this is a very important site for Verizon Wireless. We wouldn't drag all these folks out on this nice night if this wasn't something we absolutely needed. It wasn't something the fire department didn't absolutely need. This is very important. We don't take our use of resources lightly. There are actually other hearings tonight where some of these folks could have been, and they chose to come here because this is a very important site for our network and for the Deerfield, South Deerfield Fire District. So what I want to do is I want to quickly run through the contents of the application binder that I see you have in front of you, and by doing so I may answer some of your questions in advance, but I want to familiarize yourselves with what I've got in there. And on the second page of the cover sheet is a table of contents of the 10 tabs that I provided. Under the first are the town application forms that you just cited to in your legal notice. Under the second tab is my statement of support. I'm not going to read this to you. It's already submitted to the record. I will come back and touch on it, but basically this is an existing site. It predates the enactment of the wireless bylaw, wireless section 4400, the wireless section of your bylaw. So it's an existing nonconforming structure. It's not nonconforming as to use in the sense that this is in the wireless overlay. So this use is allowed and permitted and will continue as such, but the structure is nonconforming as to certain dimensions, which I'll get into. So I've gone through all of the criteria. I'll give you a brief summary. I've gone through all the criteria of your section 2250 for your nonconforming uses, and then 4400 for the wireless straight special permit criteria, 5300 variance criteria. I basically cited to Mass General Law Section 40, Chapter 48, Section 10, and it broke that out. You know, in the statute, it's written in paragraph form, rambles on. I broke it out into four criteria that are easier to follow along on. and then concluded with some citations to federal law. As the board is aware, we're a little bit different than the typical application you get in front of you that may be asking for a special permit and a variance, in the sense that we're a federally licensed wireless facility and we're afforded certain protections under federal law that's a little bit different than the run-of-the-mill application, the run-of-the-mill applicant that's coming in and asking for relief. So in that sense, I wanted to point that out, and we are slightly different. Under the third tab is our letter of authorization from our landlord. We have a leasehold interest in the site. We actually have been there for years. We, Verizon, when we acquired RCC Atlantic, who had already been on the site, we took over that lease, took over that infrastructure. So we've been there paying rent and have a leasehold interest in that little shelter that's existing and space on the tower as well. The fourth tab is just for information to familiarize yourself. I'm sure you are aware of the property, but the field card tax map of the subject property being the fire department house. And under the fifth tab are the reports of the affidavit of Mr. Latore and then his plots. And I know you've seen these before because you've done our wireless, and it's not very complicated, but I want to just quickly give you an overview. I have a blown-up version of what you have in front of you there.
I think your radio engineer would disagree with you. It's not that complicated.
Well, what we're trying to do tonight. So basically, this is a representation of what we have now with a hole or a problem in coverage in this vicinity of the subject property that will be alleviated by installing, increasing the height and installing at the subject property. We're right now getting coverage in from the height, the tower up on the Pecumtic Ridge off of Old Pine Nook Road, the tower up there. We're coming in from Clark Mountain Road in Sunderland, and then we're coming up from Waitley at the DPW garage on Route 91. Now, some of you may say, well, I'm a Verizon customer, and I made a call out there this afternoon. What's the problem? The problem is, yeah, you may be able to get a connection now. It's coming in. The coverage in this vicinity right now is coming in from that site on Pine Nook or from Sunderland or from Waitley. And what's happened is it used to be folks were satisfied just to talk on their wireless phones. You know, of course, it's a phone, talk on it. And then it was that plus text messaging, and then that plus emailing, and that plus downloading data files and videos and so on and so forth. And what's happened now is that data transmission uses bandwidth and takes away power from an availability of connection on the periphery from the cell sites that it's coming out from, so that what happens is if you're the farther you are away from a site, and the folks closer to you get on the line or start using up bandwidth, you drop a call or can't make a call or you have problem coverage. So what's happened is because this is sort of a centrally populated area, you've got the town hall, the school, fire station, the highway, the rest area. There's a lot of activity here, a lot of usage that's drawing away from these other sites, and they're straining to try to make the connection, and it's not always working. We've got problems. We wouldn't be going through all this with all these folks spending all this money if we didn't have a problem that was legitimate. And this graphic does a pretty good job of showing you before or existing, you know, sites coming in, the purple's coming in from the Pine Nook Road site, yellow from Sunderland, purple coming up from Waitley, and how with the subject site on here, those can relax, and now we can cover the South Deerfield area, this heavily populated area with this new site. So it's a very specific reason, and it's not something that you may notice a problem all the time, but it's a problem. It's something we need to have on air here to fill that gap. So under the next tab, because we are increasing the height, we are broadcasting RF, there are questions about that. And as the board is aware, under federal law, the discussion of the environmental effects of radio frequency emissions is sort of off limits to the board to the extent that we're compliant with federal law. So the board can ask, are you compliant? And neighbors may want to know. So what we did was we hired an independent health physicist, Dr. Hayes, who's not connected to Verizon, to analyze this site with the question, are we compliant with the federal standards, yes or no? Is there any risk to health and so forth? And his conclusion is no, that you see in the bottom of the first page, based on the theoretical fields he's calculated, it's compliant with all regulatory guidelines. So that's a complete non-issue. And we offer that without waiving any of our rights or protections under federal law. We offer that as a courtesy to the board and a courtesy to members of the public to put that issue to rest. Under number 7 is our report of Mr. Shadell, the acoustical report. Cell sites typically don't give off any sound. It's an inanimate object that sits up there and broadcasts. However, there are two sources of potential sound. One is that we're going to have equipment cabinets inside that existing shelter, and they have to be It has to be air exchange or cool, so there's going to be a small fan in the side of the building, but it's on the way, side away from the neighbors to the rear. It's on the firehouse side, so it's really a non-issue, but we have to mention that because that is a source of sound, potentially. And then we want to install our own DC-powered, small, modern, efficient, quiet, DC-powered emergency standby power generator so that we can remain on air in the event of a power failure or a blackout. This is something that Verizon does nationwide. It's been part of our build program for years. It's one way that we stand apart from our competitors who don't do this. Some other carriers do, some don't. So that if there's a blackout, the time when you need to have your wireless phone work, we can continue to operate uninterrupted. And we're, in fact, going back to a lot of older sites now that weren't fitted with those years ago and trying to retrofit them. So this is a very important part.
Could I ask a question about the intake fan? Or is that not appropriate? Okay. Can you tell me the size and the power of the single cooling fan?
You know that, Mr. Shazam?
I believe it's on the plans, which I would have taken off. But I didn't put those details in my notes.
It's a such a de minimis.
I can explain.
Okay.
I'm Doug Roberts. That's the design group. It's on sheet A1. We have a 19 by 19 inch exhaust fan.
Okay.
It's 2,500 by 600 CFM.
All right. Thank you.
And that'll be placed on a thermostat so that when wintertime it wouldn't run necessarily, but if in the summertime the temperature in that space gets
Thank
you.
I have a question on the generator. What is the fuel for the generator?
Diesel.
Diesel?
Yeah. It's in a self-contained double-walled belly tank, so it's...
Will the noise be observable at the property line?
No. So that's the purpose of Mr. Stell's report under tab 7 okay. there, is that he analyzed that and took measurements of the ambient during the day and the night, and then did calculations based on what would the increase be, if any, with the existence of the generator and this cooling fan. And his conclusions are that even in the event of a nighttime emergency during the hottest time of year, so in other words, the generator's running and the fan's going, these worst-case equipment emissions will be less than the nighttime ambient sounds, so they're not expected to be noticeable. So that, again, is a non-issue. And that generator we're proposing is a modern, you know, it's not like the old clunky things that rattle and wake everyone up. I mean, they make some really efficient ones now that are much quieter. So that is the purpose of Mr. Shadell's report, to prove that it's a non-issue to members of the community.
So I'm going to throw you a real curveball on the generator. Let's see if you can answer this one. Is the generator going to be any part of demand shed plan? You know what that is?
No.
So what happens is you can sign up with the utility company. If you have a generator that will power your domain, and what you can do is they will call you like August 3rd when it's really demand, and say, shed your load, turn on your generator and run it, and you get money back.
Not part of that.
So I just want to make sure you know.
Yeah, this is just a standby.
Yep, all right.
Okay, and then under number 8 is a report of a real estate consultant. He couldn't be here this evening. I put his name on that sheet. He unfortunately had a medical emergency, but his purpose of hiring him is one of the standards of your consideration is a finding that this new installation, because it's an existing non-conforming structure, we're proposing to rebuild an existing non-conforming structure. Conforming structure that will not have more deleterious impact than the existing and so forth. So one of those would be effect on property values. And Mr. LeMay was hired to analyze that question. And there's already a tower there. Folks moved into the neighborhood with a tower there. It's a fire station where you'd expect to see a tower anyway. So his professional conclusion is that that'll be a non-impact as well on property values. So we submit that report under tab 8. And under tab 9 are some photo simulations where we went around the neighborhood and we had an engineering firm produce simulations of what the new tower might look like from various perspectives and other places where it's not visible. Then under the last tab are the plans, and I have a full-size set of those up here. If you're familiar with the site, the fire station, Greenfield Road right here, entrance, you know, Route 116 entrance to the highway right there, and it's in the back corner of the firehouse. Now this, you may not be familiar with this, but if you've driven into the property, you know this is paved and here's the building, and then there's this detention pond down here that's actually part of the subject property. And that is a wetland resource that we've already gone to the Conservation Commission and gotten permission to do our work within the buffer zone, so that's been taken care of. But this is the location of the existing facility. And then as these plans go up in number, they go zoom in on perspective. So now here's a closer view of it, existing utility shed, existing tower. And then we get another perspective here where we're proposing, go to like this A1 where you can really see both the generator and the existing equipment shelter. That's not going to change. We're going to use that as is. What we're going to do is take out the existing tower, take down the structure and remove the foundation, and then put the new one up in the exact same location, and then fence it off again. So there won't be any change really other than we're going from a non-conforming lattice structure that's structurally failing and unable to be used really in the proper modern day sense, and replacing it with a stout modern monopole structure in the exact same spot and fence it all off, same shelter. And then this generator is going to be up at the far end of the property. I go back. Yeah, we wanted to get that as far away from the neighbors, as far away from the wetlands, because we are using a diesel fuel source, and we have a wetland resource here. The generator is going to be up here at the north end of the parking lot, off to the side, so that it's away from the neighbors, away from the residents, and then we just trench underground to connect it back. So that is another reason why our acoustical report came in so nicely, is we're kind of moving that away from everybody and sticking it out over there, and we're keeping the fuel source, even though it has redundancy against leaks, we're keeping it away from the wetland resource. So it's pretty straightforward as far as what we're doing now. In the meantime, see, the firehouse has to keep operating. And so what we're going to have to do during construction is put up some sort of a temporary structure. And I don't know if that's been finalized for sure yet, but there are different ways to do that. There are these devices called COWS, that's an acronym for cell on wheels. There are also temporary ballasted type structures. You can also just set a utility pole temporarily and then remove it. But whatever that happens will be done with proper permits through the building inspector for a temporary structure. We'll have to comply with 780 CMR for, you know, all the, for proper structural integrity and so forth, but it's temporary. It'll be removed once the new thing goes up. Then we transfer the antennas over. That comes off site. The existing failing lattice tower comes off site. It's all cleaned up and we're back to normal.
Excuse me, how long of a time lag do you think that'll be for the construction?
Don't you know that?
Sure. I would imagine from the start of construction to taking and removing the temporary tower, I would imagine 12 to 16 weeks. Mm-hmm. Again, weather dependent, right. You know, if we start this thing wintertime again, it might be differently. One of the big unknowns, for us is, you know, we're proposing a caisson because of its close proximity to we're building within an upland review area, but also the wetlands. So we want to minimize the impact. So that's kind of a not complicated, but there's not a whole lot of kind of construction around. So.
Right. Okay. 3 to 4 months.
Yeah. It's not a large extended time.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
So, if I go back to section 2, I just want to very quickly, I don't want to read this to you, but I just want to touch on the legal aspects of our petition in the sense that we're asking for a special permit to rebuild an existing nonconforming structure. Why is it nonconforming? The special permit part, under section 2250, the board has the authority to offer a special permit to reconstruct, extend, or structurally change an existing nonconforming structure. And it's nonconforming because it was built in 1993. The wireless bylaw was enacted in 1998. It had already been up there. There's a lot to exist. It's been up there ever since, operating and so forth. But what we're doing now is when we rebuild it, it's going to be in the exact same spot. And we're going up in height. And height's okay because under your section 4400, you can go up to 120 feet, and we're only proposing 85. So it's conforming there. However, section 4400 also has these setbacks. For example, one times height fall zone, which we don't need, 500 feet to a residential property line. Well, I mean, we don't need that. And then we don't need that, and we're not moving it to increase that in the sense that we're getting any closer. I mean, we're basically like for like, same spot and so forth. However, and this is why I wrote in my application, to the extent it's required, we respectfully request a dimensional variance. But if the board, after I explain this, if the board says, really, that's it, I don't know, I think you're overthinking it, then we'd respectfully ask to withdraw that portion and continue with the special permit. But the reason I included dimensional variance is because now, if we have to be one times height and we don't meet that, but now we're going up 20 feet, Well, in theory, now we're kind of increasing that nonconformity, right? Because now we're 20 feet higher than, and we still don't meet it. And the same with that, the 500-foot distance to residential property line, that's not changing. So that's not changing. We're X number of feet away now. We're the same again later. That's not changing at all. The height is allowed up to 120. But to the extent that we're going higher, one could read, well, you know, now that one-times fall zone, that's being increased in nonconformity. And there's a provision under your section 2250 that the reconstruction, extension, or structural change of a nonconforming structure that increases an existing nonconformity shall require the issuance of a variance. So that's when I was reading this, I thought, well, we're not moving it, and we're going to the exact same spot, but it could be perceived that we're increasing that just by the virtue of going up. So that's where I've included that. Now, if the board concurs that's necessary, I can run through all the criteria of 48 section 10 and why we believe we meet the standards of variance, which I know are very difficult to meet, but I've laid those out in my brief, and I can also reiterate them. And I also pointed out that as a federal licensee, we are afforded additional protections. There's a case called Nextel v. Whalen from the First Circuit that basically came to the conclusion that the need to close a significant gap in coverage is another grounds for a variance. That's where we're a little bit different. I know you have probably petitioners in front of you on routine evenings. They need a variance for a tool shed or whatever, and you're looking at it and it's like, I don't know if they really met the standard. I think we've laid out the standard. I'm willing to go through that with you, but we also have the federal case law that says we are allowed a variance in these instances where denying it would prohibit our service. And so that's the case here, where if we can't build this, if we can't get on here, we have those gaps in coverage. And then the result would be, in our opinion, something more deleterious to the neighborhood than simply allowing us to rebuild this, because now we'd have to build a new tower someplace else, someplace that wasn't already impacted by one the way this neighborhood is. So for those foregoing reasons, we respectfully request your approval for the application of plans as submitted. If the board, under the discussions, deems the variance not necessary, we respectfully request it be withdrawn or be removed. But we've given you everything and advertised for everything so that we're covered as far as how the board may feel in that regard. And again, I've introduced these experts. They're all available. So if there are any specific questions. Yes, sir.
In moving the generator to the north part of the property, there's some contemplation that property may be developed. How much noise is actually going to be there once that generator is there? Is it going to be something that's going to be noticeable at the property line or not?
No, it's a very quiet modern generator. That's
okay. I just want to make sure, because there's some thought that there could be a substantial building built on that. And I just want to make sure that it's not going to be a noise hindrance.
To stay on the same line with generators, because that's what we're talking about. Many times with generators, they're on an automatic run cycle too, so that at some point during the week they fire up, they run, and then they shut down saying, yeah, I'm okay.
Yes.
Do you know when you're planning to do that?
We can schedule that anytime you want. You know, on a Tuesday.
Do we have an existing generator now?
Yes, sir. We do at the fire department rather than right now. And one of the suggestions we have is to run them both at the same time. This generator, you know, it's not the standard generator like we've had at the highway garage. It's not the big bunker thing that you know, the stack on it, you know, is this big and we're putting out 250K. It's charging a 12-volt battery for what it's doing. You know, it's not a true power issue. And my general understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, but if they go down, they're going to run off the battery pack. And when the battery pack is gone down low, then this generator would be go ahead and run it to bring the battery level back up to where it goes.
Do you know what the KW is of the generator?
Either 15, 10, 15.
Yeah, it's
okay.
When do you test yours, Mr. Sarvo?
It varies. I mean, we can put it on a schedule. I mean,
we could coordinate with the fire chief.
I think that's a great thing, Chief. If we can coordinate them to a non-intrusive time for
our generator is 23 plus years old, so it doesn't have the modern technology where it's got the exerciser built into it. We manually have to go turn it on. So okay. You know, we can work with them and figure out if it's Friday at 9 a.m.
Yeah. You know, that'd be wonderful.
Yes.
You know, it doesn't start up at 3 o'clock in the morning.
No. It's typically a weekday.
And 15 KW is really small. I understand that.
So, Mr. Chairman, if I could suggest a condition of approval, we've seen with other communities is that the generator be tested between the hours of 10 and 2 on a weekday.
Yeah.
Non-holiday weekday or something like that.
I just want to work with you.
Is it a weekly thing? Twice a month?
Weekly.
Two weeks.
Two weeks?
Once every 2 weeks.
Okay. The old AC ones were weekly. This is once every 2 weeks.
Not greater than once a week. Would take care of it, right?
Yeah.
And the duration? An hour?
Half hour.
Except in emergencies when you have to use it.
Right. And then that's when other people wheel their old clunker out of the garage and everything.
That's fine.
I do believe they are exercised once a week on Tuesdays. And Carl hit it on the head, 10 o'clock. It is a sort of standard Verizon, you know.
So standard interest.
Boilerplate.
Yeah, I mean, they just kind of do them because that's the day and the time, and they report themselves to the switch if they're running.
Yeah.
It is a weekly.
Okay.
Not greater than once a week.
All right. Other questions?
Has there been any investigation into other properties? I mean, I'm sure that you've looked. Is there anything, you know, further up the highway, out of town? Could you touch on that a little bit?
No, because this is, it's an existing site. So we always look for, when the real estate folks are given the direction by the RF engineers, hey, we need a site in the area. The first thing they look for are existing sites, and there are no other existing sites. The nearest towers are the ones that they cite, so down at Waitley at the DPW garage, up on the Old Pine Nook Road, and then over in Sunderland. The other buildings around town, there are no skyscrapers or towers, so we've honed in on this because it's a site, and we inherited this from RCC. We've been paying rent there, we're there now. And when the fire department, we got wind of the fire department wanted to rebuild that, we did a deal actually that's very advantageous to the South Deerfield Fire District in the sense that we're footing the bill for this whole thing. It's not costing them a dime, and then we give them the tower, and it's theirs. And it's a very generous situation, so we always look for existing sites, and I believe your buyer's bylaw encourages co-location on existing sites, so here we are on this existing site.
So will they have the ability to let others put their equipment on that site?
Yes.
So you could have a competitor on the same?
We share now. You know, 25 years ago, wireless companies didn't want to share, and that went away pretty quickly. So now we have sharing agreements with everyone. So I want to go on your tower, you go on mine.
So the fire district has the ability to allow somebody else.
Oh, absolutely. And actually, we have no say in that because they're gonna.
I just want to.
But that increases their exposure. If there are other people on the monopole, then that increases the fire department's exposure. My assumption is.
What exposure are you talking about?
You
could load that up with every carrier that has a license in the market, and it would still be so far below the federal standard, it's completely not an issue.
In a couple of minutes, I'm going to ask the fire department to speak upon the benefits for the fire department. Oh. So we'll let him
get there. I have one more question. The facility on Pine Nook, the tower up there. I understand that there's been a new lease negotiated on that, and you're going to be rebuilding that also?
You'll be seeing me in the coming months again, yes.
So you need that there plus this tonight to
We're up there now, and that's still...
What I'm saying is to increase your public service in this whole valley.
Yes, absolutely.
You're talking on Potomac?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I just want to, you know... This isn't going to replace that.
No.
All
right. I'll be back in a few months to talk about that one.
I just piece the pie.
All right, so are you good?
Yes.
All right. If the Prudential Committee and or the Chief would like to speak about a little bit about this project and what it means to the town, what it means to the fire department, would be really nice.
My name's Bill Swayze. I'm the Chief of the South Deerfield Fire Department. This radio antenna was installed some 23 years ago, and the main purpose for it is emergency communications. The cell is secondary. It allows us a revenue source that assists with the taxpayers in town. It allows us to maintain a stable tax rate. But the primary use for this radio antenna is emergency communications, period. The county radio system is 10 plus years old. It's older technology. By allowing this to go a little bit higher, we bounce off of Shelburne Mountain and Toby Tower. So down here in the valley, we're blocked by North Sugarloaf, and then we've got the whole ridge up on the other side of South Mill River Road and Upper Road. So, you know, we've had some struggles in the past about getting you know, radio communications out there. A lot of the equipment's obsolete now. New technology. If you have a scanner at home, you probably would listen this afternoon, multiple test tones for Whately, for Sunderland, for other towns. Conway was one of them because they're trying to fix the system. They don't have the $20 million to put a whole new county radio system in. So they're working with what they have. They're trying to make improvements. And this will give us a great impact, especially down here in the district. Right now, we go into a commercial establishment, Frontier Regional, Deerfield Elementary School, Yankee Candle, Pliant. We can't talk out onto the radio system. We can talk amongst each other on a tactical channel, but we can't communicate up to Shelby Control and our dispatchers. We also want to be self-sufficient. We had found out what you may not consider to be a long time, but for me, Shelby Control, their console went down for about 4 to 6 hours. They could not tone out any of the fire departments. They were working off one of the members' portable radios. As soon as that was relayed to us, I instructed our full-time guy to get a hold of our radio person. We had them install the tones for our own fire pagers into our radio. We also installed South County EMS's tones, Sunderland Fire's, Whately Fire, and Deerfield Fire. You know, we wanted to think of, you know, this group, and we wanted to make sure we were doing the right thing and protecting. We would have done more, but that's all that was allowed in our system. The South Deerfield Fire Station also is the emergency operations center for the town of Deerfield. We've activated it several times during some of the natural disasters, during some of the inclement weather events. We've got, you know, the police there, DPW there, the water department, if they need to be there. On this radio, on this antenna, the top antenna on this monopole will be the countywide police fire radio. Also on this monopole will be the DPW radio antenna and the water district radio antenna. We also have one for Hampshire County, so we can monitor down there, you know, due to the fact that mutual aid. So, you know, like I said, you know, the rent and that stuff is secondary for the fire district. The primary reason for this monopole and the improvements is for emergency communications.
So with that said, this is a question that I think is good for the public. How much money does the fire district collect in rent per month or year?
Last year we got $29,600.
So for the town folks, when I say the town folks, actually for the fire district, because there's a fire district tax, it's offset by approximately $30,000. And I don't know what you guys negotiated for new rent, but it is a source of revenue for the fire department. Thank you.
Thanks.
Any questions? I have a few, but I'd like to hear other people. Okay. All right. So I've got a couple of questions, and you might have been in front of us before several
yes,
times.
I have.
The only question I have, and this would go for your radio engineer or your antenna engineer, how far apart are the, what I'm going to call the antennas?
Platform?
The top, yeah.
It's a 14-foot platform, 14-foot platform.
From the center, so is that sticks out 7 feet?
No, equilateral triangle.
Yeah, so from the center of it, how
yes,
far does it stick out? The center of the monopole, approximately. 7 feet on each side?
Well,
I think it's 12.
It's a 14-foot triangle, you're in the middle, so it'd be...
Okay.
Yeah, a little less than that.
Is that the minimum that you can go with the antennas?
Yes, that's the standard mounting platform.
Standard versus, is it the minimum?
Yes.
The standard is different than the absolute
yeah,
minimum.
Yeah. No, I know because we, I know you had this question when I did the other.
When you do the other, I just want to keep that
yes,
footprint
absolutely,
as absolutely small as possible.
Yes.
And, you know, from an aesthetics point of view.
Right.
You know, we don't want it to look like a tree with branches hanging way out.
Right.
Because the pole itself is not intrusive at all. It's when you start to hang all the
right,
hardware off of it.
Yep.
So that would be my only question is, you know, if you use a bigger antenna, a different style antenna, I've been down this road before.
Yep.
Or whatever, I want to minimize that footprint to the absolute minimum.
Right.
And I see there's a couple smaller antennas down a little bit lower. Whose are those?
Those are the fire department.
Well,
public safety.
The smaller ones are going to be the DPW, the water district, intercom radio.
Are those existing now?
Yes.
All right. And when you said you were on a trench, the railroad tracks are there. You got to be careful that you're within.
Yeah, no, we're going to be right off the grass, right off the parking lot in the grass.
The trench was lanes in between.
Oh, there's, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay. All right. Any other questions or comments or anything? No? All right, so we're all set with you for a minute.
Okay.
And I wanted to see if anybody from the public is here to speak in opposition. Duly noted, none. Anybody from the public that would like to speak here as a proponent? Not heard, duly noted. In the fire, all three of you folks are taxpayers in town. You have the right to speak if you wanted to. I know, that's... I wonder if we can figure that out. All right. So with that, if we don't have anything else, we can go to deliberation, we can talk, and we can put T's and C's on if we want, and then we can go forward. So if anybody wants to, we'll just start to talk, and then we'll go to deliberation. Anybody want to talk about it or anything?
I think it's going to provide for greater public safety from the way it was explained, and it's probably in the best interest for the public to allow this with the restriction of the running of the generator only once a week, you know, to test the generator, and the others as they've specified. But that's my feeling. But I think you guys are going to vote, and I'm going to sit here aside.
So I guess I'm not sure where the debate between the monopole and the lattice. Can the lattice ones be used anymore, or are those... I know our zoning
The lattice is shorter in height, and the monopole's like 25 feet taller. Could they build a lattice? Maybe, but probably today's technology, a monopole is, you know, I don't want to say... It's probably quicker, less expensive, more durable. You know, it's the new generation of antennas.
I think I know where you're going, because that's one thing I did notice looking through the photographs, and it's definitely more of a signature.
And if you drive by it, too, you don't see the lattice one.
Yeah, there is, I did notice through the photos, which I think actually was very good to have it like that, to be able to see what the difference would be, because otherwise it might be kind of a shock going from one to the other, because there is view almost through the lattice.
Right.
But, yeah, I thought the same thing, that there might have been some folks that might have come in tonight worried about that.
Right.
That change there, but I understand probably the advancement of the sturdiness of it being a monopole, certainly what you see everywhere.
Yeah, I thought the same thing, because I thought that the monopole looked more more visible and so
more of
forth.
A presence.
But then I was thinking, is when do you see it? Is when you're coming down the hill on 116. So if you're shooting directly up, you get a highway, you don't have like a house across the street.
And that poor, they put that one picture in that showed that bridge over the highway, that thing looks like it's about ready to crumble anyway.
Yeah, so, you know, other than, and apparently there's not a, there's some residents around that area that didn't show, so I have to look at it as, if they're not showing and they were notified,
right,
that they're okay with it. I have to assume that.
I just want to make a comment first. Is the fire department, there's a full-time fire department, so they sleep there. They don't.
The South County EMS, they do have staff members there, but the fire department's not.
Does not, but South County sleeps there?
Correct.
Okay. So that's my only problem, and they don't get to speak.
Okay.
So I know personally, I would not want to live under this giant tower, knowing that I'm a South Deerfield resident, and I think it's going to be terrific for the emergency, you know, for the emergency department. It worries me in the long run what happens to our first responders in the long run living under that, especially as the monopole grows and more people put their things on it. I don't have a lot of trust in the numbers in it, because we're not going to be able to talk about it. That's where I'm coming from.
Okay.
So that's how That's how I feel. The public got a chance to come, but I'm not, but the people who work in the building that stays there.
Go ahead.
I was just going to point out that the South County is currently based there, but that's only got another year and for one more extension. Am I correct, Chief?
Yeah, I mean, we're going to work with South County, you know, to the end of time. So if they need extensions, you know, we're yeah. here to support them.
So one of the things I think will happen, and if not, as far as the fire department, listen to this carefully. One of the restrictions that I was going to maybe say we put on any additions to the antennas, they got to come back here. So if they want to have, I don't know who a competitor is, but competitor B, or they want to put something on that tower, they got to come back in to us for us to update the permit. Is what I'm thinking, and I think that would be because they'd be if they put anything on it, they're going to be making it more non-conforming than it already is. So at that point, if you know those old big dishes are gone away, but if some technology comes back where they're trying to do those old big dishes again, you know, that would be something that I agree we'd want to be take a hard look at and approve or not approve it. So conditionally, I'd like to make it that they've got to come back to if they make that tower any more non-conforming than per the design that is presented.
Ron, I have one more question. What's the distance between the new monopole and the current fire station building? Is it 75 or 100 feet?
The pad?
Yeah,
the pad is in the current.
If the tower came flopping down, it's not going to hit the building. That's my question.
The tower is designed to fold onto itself, so that's a complete non-issue as well. It's 55 feet away, but the tower has been designed so that it'll have a buckle point, so that it would fold onto itself. And we've ordered engineering report from a company that specifically designs towers like that, and they've never had a failure. The site that Hurricane Katrina and these tornadoes.
So there's no likelihood it could fall on a building?
No.
But it could fall on a truck if there was one.
It would fall on itself.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm just curious.
Yeah. No, we thought about that. Obviously, in a condition like that. That's been taken care of.
Then I guess.
Did you give us the, do we have anywhere in here the original variance that we gave for that?
I think I asked Pat to pull it. Did she leave it in the stuffer tonight? I mentioned it to her the other day. She may have not found it.
I did. That's the problem. But hey, not as sharp as I used to be, Chief.
Well, I guess I don't see it in here, just some okay. letters, but then.
Back in what I can recall back when we originally gave it, and if any of you, Stash, you're probably the one that would remember, been there the longest. I think we had to give you a variance for the height because it was over 35 feet and it was considered a structure. And many of the popular guy type. Many of the times that's what it is, the height variance. And I know you talked that you're exempt and so forth because of the new federal laws, but we've gone around that block before too. So. I think what I would think we would need to do is give them a variance for the height of it.
Actually, the height is conforming. Your bylaw, section 4400, allows towers up to 120 feet. So this
in, I think in, I think they are, but they're in approved zone.
This is an approved zone. This is the wireless overlay district.
This is in the wireless overlay. Okay, great. That's fantastic. Then.
Yeah, so there's no problem with the height.
Okay.
It's yeah. just a matter of whether the increase in height that's adds right. to an increase in non-conformity.
Yeah. Due to its setbacks. That's it.
Okay.
Right.
You know, I personally don't have any real problems. I'm just trying to protect us.
Right.
The best way that we possibly can be protected.
No,
I protect the fire district the best we can, as well as the town's.
Like you said, if there was some great groundswell of, you know, anti this new kind of pole right there, the neighbors.
Right.
Yeah.
But short of that, yeah, I agree.
This is something that's very typical to be seen in fire stations all across the
Yeah.
We do this all the time. And it's a benefit to the fire district.
I hope they got more money too. So, all right. Anybody got any kinds of motions or anything they'd like to make?
Well, so we're dealing with two issues. We've got a
special permit
and a variance.
Yeah, I would err. I'd rather err on the safe side and provide you both so that we don't have to come back or whatever. And as you're well aware, people can challenge our decisions and tie things up if they wanted to. But it doesn't appear like that's the case.
So I make a motion for a special permit. But with...
Pat just texted and said that the file is here. So
nice.
For the original.
I mean, this one right here?
Right.
Original.
Thank you, Pat. This is original antenna file.
Technology. I get the feeling you're being watched.
Yeah.
Do you want to look through that first?
Yeah, let me just look at it real quick.
Do you want to recess for a little while?
No, just take two minutes. Unless you need a recess.
I always take a while.
You need a bio.
I'd rather stay here and not let you run away and get talking.
Sent me a text to
Yeah, no.
Is it matching your memory or is it?
It's something that's good so far. Just as a point of reference, back in 1997 when they put it, we were going to put it up, it looked pretty intrusive. Mm-hmm. Then, I can say, all the time it's been there, it's never even.
I'll call you back later.
I was looking to see if there were any special conditions back then. That's what I was looking for, just so that we would be consistent with what we had in the past. There's always the question that we have, which is when the technology changes and you guys go satellite, what do you do with the antenna then? Who dismantles it and takes it away?
The tower's going to be owned. We're going to turn over the towers to the fire district. There's simply a tenant on there after the construction.
So it becomes their property?
That's right.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I know you're looking for conditions, sort of, but this and current application would supersede any of that in the sense we're asking for new relief now, so we respectfully approve a lot of what we've got.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so it really looks like what we just gave, granted a special permit in the past for it. And there doesn't seem to be, I haven't seen any terms and conditions.
Okay, so she wanted to do the special permit first?
Sure.
And if we were to include the couple of conditions that we mentioned, that the gen set to only be test run at those certain hours, something like between 10 and 2 on a weekday, and that any additions or extensions to the antenna would require coming back before this board?
To the tower unit?
Yes.
Yeah. So what that means is if you come back and you want to change your antenna configuration, you got to come back here.
Actually, Mr. Chairman, I just want to correct you respectfully. If we wanted to change our antennas out under federal law now, we're allowed to do that with a building permit only. That's no longer subject to a discretionary zoning type of application. We can agree that an extension or exchange of the structure, the folks would have to come back, and that would be whatever applicant would sign up at the fire department. That would not be Verizon at that point. But we, under federal law, now can swap our antennas out under building permit only. I know that's a little bit different.
Not to be any more. You can change an antenna out, but you can't change the size of the antennas.
We can. There are federal guidelines on what's deemed substantial and what's not. So as long as we stay within those federal guidelines, we can do that under building permit only. And the Mass Attorney General has actually concurred with that opinion. It's a federal law, but the Mass Attorney General has opined that they concur that as long as an applicant is complying with the terms of those federal guidelines, that a special permit, a discretionary special permit type of procedure can no longer be required.
So where does the structure and the antenna end then? Is the antenna actually just the vertical piece mounted to the triangular structure?
Yeah, the antenna, just like a panel antenna, like a right. light fixture type thing.
So you wouldn't be able to change the mounting
bracketry.
So the whether we use the Acme antenna or the Mitsubishi antenna, I mean, we change antennas every 6 months practically. Our engineers always messing with it. We're trying to maximize our coverage to our customers without having to build a new site. So what they do before they build a new site is they'll tweak and let's try different antennas, so forth. That we can do now as of right under federal law.
So are you telling me you can put a dish out there if you want to put a dish out there?
Yes, that's what he's telling you. Once it goes up with just a building permit. Now.
Yeah.
Yes.
We're not looking to do that. I'm just...
But it's once, well, once it's
I just
out
want to make
Verizon's
sure the conditions written that something that we can live with in the sense that antenna swapping out, this and that, no, we can't. We're not going to come back for that. We don't need to under federal law anymore.
If we put in the condition that if you make it any more, any larger than what's on the plans, I have no problems if you make it smaller.
To the extent we're compliant with 47 CFR 1.4001, that 0001, that's the actual federal statute that governs
antenna swaps and antenna and tower modifications now. I don't mean to be
disrespectful. Do you have that? Can you tell me what it is?
Does that address sizes of antennas? Does that address the dimensions?
Yeah, dimensions, a bunch of different things. The height of the tower, expanding the compound. If this, for example, was one of these fake pine trees, someone couldn't come along and do something to render it not a fake pine tree anymore. Or a flagpole would be a better example. If this was one of these flagpole styles, someone couldn't come around and then start bolting antennas on the outside to render it no longer stealth. You know, there are various criteria like that. So we will absolutely comply with federal law. So you could write your condition in that to the extent that we comply with federal law, we don't have to come back. But I thought you were, when I heard you discussing this condition, that it was the tower itself, which I'm thinking, all right, normally I'd maybe want to engage in that, but this is going to be turned over to the fire district, and I'm sure they will just tell whoever comes along, you've got to get your own permits, and here's what the rent's going to be, go do your thing and come back, just like we're here tonight at our expense to get this permit. So the future applicants on this tower would have to come.
I'm on board with you with that, okay. But I'm also not on board with you just having carte blanche, I'm going to change any antenna I want to put out there.
Yeah, we can actually do that now.
We can deny you your special permit.
A special permit isn't required anymore. That's what I'm saying.
That's what you're here for.
Oh, for this, yes.
So we can deny the tower altogether.
I just want to
be clear. I don't care what the federal government says because I don't trust the federal government as far as I can throw them. And this is Deerfield. This is not Washington. And what we want here isn't what Washington wants. And what your lobbyists pay for isn't to protect us. And I'm here to protect this town. So we got an option. You can work with us. And if you want to put a rule in there that says, if it's any more than 10%, or you give me some figures, then I'll comply or help you. But if you think I'm giving you carte blanche, you can throw an antenna out there anytime you want. Not going to happen.
Well, the federal law talks about an extension of more than 20 feet away from the tower.
20 feet is a huge distance.
If someone wanted to do that, they would have to come back to get a special permit. If they're below that, they don't. We're talking about a 14-foot equilateral triangle platform. We're keeping that. We're not changing that. And then we're talking about on that, taking down the XYZ.
So then you shouldn't be opposed. If you're going to do everything you're saying you're going to do, you shouldn't be opposed to say, if the antenna size is greater than 10% beyond plan, we're willing to come back.
No, the antenna size is not what's exempt from the federal law. Does antenna size, antenna models, and so forth, can no longer, local boards can no longer say which antenna you're allowed to use. That used to be a sort of an out of control thing, not necessarily in this town, but other places where our engineers wanted to pick a different antenna, we wanted to tweak the system. They had to go back and file full zoning applications all over again. That the purpose of this federal law was to allow for the wireless companies to propagate their signal, expedite the development of this by just using the best antenna that the experts choose without having to have a discretionary discussion about it. If we wanted to increase the tower height by more than a certain number of feet or increase the width or expand outside the compound, those are things that then aren't exempt. So to the extent that we comply with the federal law, you know, and of course we have to come back if we wanted to go 20 feet out, which we don't, though. We're talking about a 14-foot platform, keeping that platform, but just maybe in a few years we want to swap an antenna out or something. That doesn't need to come back. That's a building permit only at this point.
So if you want to swap an antenna out and you want to put a larger antenna on there, you can. If you want it to go from, I'll call it a 6-inch panel by 4 feet, and you want it to go to a 4-foot panel by 8 feet tall, you're telling me you can do that with a permit.
We can, although that example is a little unreal.
But let me tell you.
All right.
And you're going to get my lecture. I've been on this board since 1980, and I've had trust me, just to be not trusted. And I'm not saying that to you. My position on this board is to protect the town of Deerfield and the taxpayers of Deerfield. And I really don't care what the federal law says or whatever. And if it means that I got to reject the entire special permit for your cooperation, I'll do that. So I think you need to come to some agreement if we are going to increase our size of antenna. I don't care if you decrease it down to nothing, but if you're going to increase your antennas 10% in dimension or some number that's reasonable, you're going to come back to this board.
Excuse me, respectfully, I hear that if we do this, we lose a lot of control to the federal government, whomever. I'm very concerned about these numbers. I don't trust.
Right,
for a number of reasons, and I'm concerned about that significantly, that these are just these numbers right now, and then as soon as this happens, it's out of our hands.
And that's exactly what happens.
Right. And I'm just...
Let Jamie finish first, please.
Okay. So I'm very hesitant for that reason.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Might I suggest that we take it under advisement and so that we can discuss it with council as to what's permissible, what's not permissible, and the board get proper advice before we grant something that we may regret later or deny something that we might regret later, and put it off till we get opinion from council, and then the board can vote, and so that we don't make any fast decisions or make any mistakes tonight. And that's up to you. I'm going to sit to the side. You guys are going to vote.
Yeah,
I'm
think.
Well, Mr. Latore, the RF engineer, is something we'd like to contribute that may solve this evening. I don't want to have to come back, and if we don't need to.
Thank you, Carl. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. My name is Jay Latore. I'm a radio frequency engineer at Verizon Wireless. I just wanted to give you all the opportunity to ask any questions to me as the radio frequency engineer, as I'm the person that's responsible for not only the antenna design for this facility, but as my design area includes all of Western Massachusetts, I would be the person in the future, should the board grant this tower and Verizon Wireless build it, it would be one of my daily responsibilities to evaluate this tower, as I do all the other facilities in this area, to look at potential improvements to the facility, which could include the removal of certain antennas and replacement with new antennas. What I wanted to do is just give you a little bit of information, because your concerns are legitimate, and I do understand why you want to have this conversation and do your due diligence on behalf of the town. But I just wanted to share a little bit information about what we're proposing, so that hopefully it could help frame your concerns, and maybe I can even address some of them. What Verizon Wireless is proposing is a total of 12 antennas to be installed on this tower on the 14-foot platform. And I will mention, just so you are aware, in my 5.5 years with the company, I've had very limited times where we have, maybe one that I can think of, where we've changed out a platform for something else. And to be perfectly honest with you, I can't recall if it was something larger or something smaller. It's not a very common occurrence, but certainly it is something that could happen. And I don't want to speak as a radio frequency engineer to whether that requires zoning or not. I just want to share information on how often that kind of thing happens. Now, speaking to the proposed facility itself, we're proposing 4 antennas per antenna face, which we would call a sector, a 3-sector solution, which is very common in the wireless industry, so that the overall site provides a 360-degree radius of coverage. The reason we deploy 4 antennas is very simple. Verizon Wireless in this particular area owns 4 different frequency licenses, and in our service to our customers, we like to make all of those services available or put ourselves in a position to add them in the future as demand occurs for them. In this proposal here, we're proposing 2 antennas per sector for a total of 6 that are approximately 8 feet tall, and 2 antennas per sector for a total of 6, making the total that are approximately 6 feet tall. Now, you mentioned a couple of things in regarding to the different heights and widths of antennas, and I wanted to just talk to you a little bit about that. I will tell you that in areas like Deerfield and the surrounding areas that are more suburban and the distance between facilities is, you know, a little bit further than, let's say, you know, where I'm from in Springfield, where the sites are very close from one another. It is very common, and it is something that I commonly do, to deploy antennas in the 6 to 8 foot range, because the antenna providers that we've worked with build antennas typically in three sizes, 4 feet, 6 feet, and 8 feet. And very simply, the taller your antenna, the greater the gain, and the greater that the signal can project to our customers. Now, here's something that could happen as you and Carl were going back and forth. There could be something that occurs in the future where, should the tower be granted an approval, and we turn on the facilities and decide that some of our services could benefit from some additional gain or a different antenna that has a different type of width or some other technology, there could be an opportunity to increase, you know, antenna height from 6 foot to 8 foot. And as you increase these antennas, they may increase in width or decrease in width by, you know, anywhere between 4 to 10 inches typically. I wanted to frame that to you because I certainly understand your example, and I understand your desire to not just benefit on the words, trust me, but from a matter of what is commonly done in industry today, those are the sizes that are common, and the standard widths are usually anywhere between around 8 to 16 inches or so in width. There are antennas out there, that kind of have that refrigerator look to them. They're used in very rare occasions, typically with our temporary towers, in very high capacity type events. For example, you might be familiar with the Big E. Verizon has a temporary tower there where we have a very large antenna we have on our cell on wheels because it can allow us to deploy multiple beams of technology to cover 100,000 people. They're not very common, and I've never used them on towers that are just meant to provide service to neighborhoods, businesses, municipalities. And then finally, the other thing I just wanted to share with you was in regards to microwave dishes. I just wanted to speak to that a little bit about what their purpose was and why they're less common today. Notwithstanding and, you know, totally understanding your concern and just, you know, wanting to get this down here. Microwave dishes for a long time were very common amongst the cellular carriers, and they are still commonly used by some of the power companies for forms of communication. And the reason for that was the cellular antennas, the rectangular ones on top of the towers, are the antennas that are utilizing your radio frequency between your phone and back to our radios. The microwave dishes were used in situations where we could not provide what we call backhaul, meaning the data trunk line, just like you might have a trunk line in this facility that goes from our mobile switching center all the way to the cell site so that our core can communicate to one another. There were cases over the years where the time and expense to build, first it was copper and now it was fiber all the way up to a tower, on top of a mountain or something of that nature, was cost prohibitive or just wasn't going to be allowed or just couldn't be constructed. You all are obviously familiar with Pecumtuk, Mountain and Shelburne. Those are huge mountains to get fiber up. And in some cases, some people have chose to utilize microwave dishes to create that connectivity in lieu of a permanent structure. Nowadays, with the emergence of our 4G LTE technology, which you may be familiar with, that stands for long-term evolution. It's our service that provides us the very high-speed data that we enjoy today on our phones. One of the requirements of that is what's something they call low latency in communication between the cell and the switching station. And one of the ways you achieve low latency is by having a direct cable connection. And so it's for that reason that microwave dishes amongst the cellular carriers, I don't want to speak for any other type of industry, are increasingly unpopular. And I'll just state for the record that in my own experience in the 5.5 years that I have been with Verizon, I have never built a facility where I proposed a microwave dish, but I have been involved in certain negotiations where we've taken them down because we no longer utilize them. I don't want to take anything away from your concerns or your points, but I just thought maybe some of that industry information might be beneficial to you to help frame that conversation. And if any of you have any other additional questions, I'd be happy to answer them if you thought it might be some benefit to your concerns.
So Mr. LaFleur, then you said an 8-footer by 16 inches, like the biggest antenna you've ever used or that you might use here?
Yeah, I don't use, when we pick out antennas, just to be clear, we don't focus on, when we're just trying to decide what we want to use, we really focus on vertical height. And the different companies, based on their technology and their radomes, will have different widths of those antennas, but they're all in that general range. But you, when I say I got to go get some additional gain out of this technology and put it on a tower, the thing I'm thinking about first is a vertical height. I'm not really looking, to say, oh, this antenna needs to be wider, because that's not what really controls the gain.
So let me say this. I totally understand what you're saying, and believe it or not, I do comprehend exactly what you're saying.
Sure.
But I want you to think about how antennas start. Think back to how rabbit ear started, and then you went to the greatest UHF grid, then the biggest VHF antenna, and so forth, then the dish, and then now this. And you don't know where technology is going. Because if you and I did, we'd be real, real rich. But in this particular case, someday the antenna, instead of being vertical, it could be conical. It could be a loop. It could, who knows what it could be. So my concern is, I don't know what the future looks like. So again, I'm not saying you're not going to get another permit, but I'm not going to let you just carte blanche put an antenna on there. As you just said, vertical height is important to you. So if I say, okay, you've got an antenna and you can put one on there, and all of a sudden you decide to take one that is 8 inches by 20 feet tall or 30 feet tall and bolt it to that framework, that's a whole lot different than the existing 8 inches or 12 inches by 8 feet. All I'm asking for is a reasonable percentage of growth, I'll grant you. I understand the difference between a Mitsubishi and another brand. I know they vary in size.
Sure.
6 inches versus 5 inches and 3/8 or whatever it may be. Right. That's not an issue. What's an issue with me is just opening a door because the feds say, and I'm going to say it again, don't care about the feds, that the feds say, I can do what I want to do. And under what you're telling me, he could put a 30-foot antenna.
That one there. Would actually violate like the statute.
But I'm just saying to you.
So what kind of condition would you suggest?
I'm asking you to give me a number.
Well, do you foresee right now an 8-footer is the maximum? Do you ever foresee a 10-footer?
I don't, but you're asking for a number, so I'll glad to give you a number, and then you and Mr. Guerin can discuss it. In Verizon Wireless world, for our internal regulatory, what we call a substantial increase. And I just want to be clear, I'm just talking about a Verizon Wireless, and I'm not trying to make a statement on what the federal statute is. We consider an increase in antenna height to be substantial when such that the height of the antenna is increased by greater than 50%. So
that's
a 6-foot, if it went greater than 9-foot, if an 8-foot antenna, if it went greater than 12 feet, that would be considered substantial to Verizon.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. And is it Verizon that's going to need to come back for permission, or would it be eventually the fire department, the fire district?
No, I think, as they said, I agree 1,000%. If the fire department wants to put another carrier on there, the carrier's going to go through what this gentleman's going through.
Correct.
And it has to be approved and so forth. What I'm asking for is on that 14-foot platform that we grant, and there's a print that shows what it's going to look like, gives me all the dimensions and so forth. If they're greater than what these prints say, they need to come back by a certain percentage. And do I think 50% of an antenna is a lot? Yeah, 50%.
So if what we're hearing is that as soon as you give this, it's out of our hands.
For changing out antennas. So it could look totally different.
Correct.
Than it looks today.
Right.
The number of antennas, the number of antennas and the size and shape of the antennas could change.
Correct.
You could limit the special permit to a number of years.
Well, So do you have something that's reasonable?
Well, I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman, I didn't hear that. I was discussing.
When in reference to the size, and correct me if I'm wrong, what you're also saying is on that platform, he's recommending, I don't have any problems, he's recommending 4 on each plane.
Right.
He could put 6 or 8 with just a building permit on that plane, 6 different antennas. He could add antennas, or can he not add any antennas?
Yeah, you can add antennas.
So don't take me the wrong way. What's on the print, it should look like a ghost. Because we don't know what the antennas would look like.
We're asking permission for 12 antennas, and we can look at 12 antennas now, right?
Correct.
In the future, could you want 16 antennas?
I want to answer your question as open and honest as possible. Could it be possible? Certainly, it could be possible. I will speak on my own personal industry experience as an employee of Verizon. Typically, as we add technology, we have been working with new antennas that allow us to combine more frequencies into the same physical antenna, rather than adding additional antennas. The challenge that we try to overcome every day is as we deploy new services to our customers, we also have to recognize that as we add additional antennas, we create, which I'm sure you're all familiar with, is additional wind loading on the tower. And therefore, we've had tremendous success with this type of platform and 12 antenna panels. And as we've had to modernize and grow these facilities over time, by sticking with that general quantity, we've been able to increase our technology available to our customers and minimize the amount of times where we've had to perform structural upgrades on the towers due to increased wind loading.
So you currently are specifying out of the 12 antennas,
yep.
How many antennas are you specifying 6 and how many are you doing 8?
Six of the antennas will be 6 feet in height and 6 of the antennas will be 8 feet.
So 36 plus 48 linear feet of antenna are on that structure.
Yes.
So if you total those two numbers together, how much linear feet growth can you go with?
Well, I mean, the
So here, I think you guys need to really have a conversation.
Sure.
And because I'm telling you, this is my vote. Mm-hmm. My vote is we come to an agreement on a number. As the plans show, or a percentage above the growth, or I'm not voting for the antenna. I'm just being open with you.
You're not voting to allow the fire district to rebuild this tower?
No.
Because of
no, because it's not. No, I'm not. So I'm not. I'm not going to fall into a trap. Don't take it the wrong way. I'm not going to fall into what's best for the fire department. I like. But what I don't like is giving Verizon carte blanche to change that antenna look. The first thing we said when we got here, when we started to deliberate, was how intrusive the monopole started to look over the traditional design. And we were kind of like giving away on that. I don't know if you were, that's what I was hearing. And now the head, your head has got me concerned. So I think you really need to talk to, I don't know who runs the show or who can make the decision.
Well, this gentleman specifies the antennas, and we can decide this right now. And just to clarify, I apologize if we weren't trying to mislead any, but these are zoning drawings. Typically, there's more detail in a construction drawing with antennas and so forth. This is just, typically antennas are shown as a typical 4 antenna per sector array for a total of 12. You know, we're here to get permission to rebuild this existing site 20 feet higher. And what antennas we put it on, which models and all that aren't even specified on here, because that's something we've discussed when we filed an application for a building permit with the building inspector. But if you're saying you won't approve this without a condition of some kind, then I would ask Mr. Latore if he could agree, could you agree to 4, 12, 12 antennas, 12 8-footers, would that be the most you'd ever need? Other than, and beyond that, we have to come back.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying we're not going to allow you after that point.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not saying,
Mr. Chairman, that would be
more than acceptable, and I would be happy to work with you on how exactly you might want to write that out as a condition of a special permit approval.
Right, so I have no problem, and I don't really have a problem with that. I have 12 antennas.
12 8-foot, in the worst case.
No more than 8 foot. Otherwise, you come back to the board for approval.
Mr. Chairman, on behalf of Verizon Wireless, we can certainly accept that.
But that's 48 against 96, right?
Well, it's 12 times 8, which is 96.
Yeah.
But I mean, the other way is 36 plus 48. So it's 80 something. It's only, it's a minute, it's not a lot of difference.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. And a question I have for the chief and the presidential committee. Do you have in your contract with them that if they abandon their equipment that they remove it? Not the monopole, but do they remove their equipment?
Yes, we do. We would do that.
Is that in your contract?
There is a clause in there about if they abandon it for a certain period of time or what, but I don't know the specifics of it. We'd have to look back.
I'm not worried about the monopole, but I'm
that's
just worried about
the condition of our approval as well. Then that's typical for towers and so forth.
Okay.
On abandonment,
right.
We welcome that as a condition.
Okay. Any other comments? I'm sorry to dominate, but
no.
Dominate away.
Any other questions?
So then we'd be talking about two conditions: one about the antenna, and the other was about the generator.
As we just talked, there would be three. One would be that the generator is synchronized or worked with the fire department for its auto cycle run, that they'd work with the fire department when they run their generator. The other one would be no more, and I'm looking at you, no more than 12 8-foot antennas. You want to give me a rough
16 inches.
What's a good number?
If you will allow me, Mr. Chairman, what I'd like to do, I don't have the specifications of those antennas, but I can look at that very quickly,
okay,
sir, and get a dimension that I would feel very comfortable with you,
right,
if you'd allow me.
And it doesn't have to be exact. I understand the difference manufacturer. And then third is that if they abandon their equipment, that they will remove their equipment. I don't expect them to remove the tower. But they remove their equipment.
Okay, and that's for a special permit?
It's for a special permit.
Okay, so I'm going to make...
Let's just wait until Jay is able to get us a width. Because we should probably... Should we word those specifically before making a motion for those conditions?
Yeah, we'll make them. The conditions.
I'm going to wait for numbers.
So 8 foot by 18 inches is would be the widest, but that's not what we're going to start out with, but that would give us a...
Where are you starting out?
So the Hollis antenna today, of which we are putting six together, and this is just straight from the CommScope website, which is the company that we're purchasing these antennas from.
Yeah.
The length is 96.6 inches exactly.
8 feet. Is,
and the width is 11.9 inches.
By a foot.
So with that 18 inches, I'm just asking for a little discretion, as we talked about. Different companies could have different sizes over time. And I'd appreciate that number. So 8 foot by length and 1.5 foot by width.
1.5.
Is that good?
We're talking 12. Traditional 12.
Yes.
And we're 18, it would be 50% in size. I'd rather go 25% in size larger. So 12 plus 3, 16 inches.
If the board felt that 16 inches was the greatest width that you would be willing to allow, then Verizon...
That's a little bit greater than 25%. Greater than what you're talking.
Sure. Okay. We will accept that.
Which is 16 inches.
16 inches.
Right. But the 96, he says it's a little bit bigger than the 96 inches.
It's 96, whether it's 96.1. We're not going up there with a tape measure.
But I'm just sort of say, if you wanted to go to not more than 100 inches, then you could take care of...
No, I think 90, because he was only asking for six 8-footers and six 6-footers. We're already giving him
I mean, if I may, Mr. Chairman, the gentleman brings up a good point. You know, antennas are advertised in 4, 6, and 8, but to that respect, you know, an 8-footer advertised could be 94 inches or could be 97.
Or could be 99 inches, right.
So if you wanted to get that particular, which, you know...
I'd rather just stay with 8-foot.
Is it, are they all referred to as 8-foot antenna?
They are. It would be, this would be the 8-foot product.
Then I would just go with 8 feet.
But to the gentleman's point, you know, they could be 98 or 96.
We're not looking to split hairs like that.
Yeah. Okay.
Just a substantial change would require coming back.
Anything a lot larger than that, they would have to come back to us. Okay.
Okay.
So.
Right. So it's a nominal 8 foot.
A nominal 8 by 16.
Yes. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So just I am going to make sure a motion. For a special permit with conditions given to Selco Partnership, doing business as Verizon Wireless, for a special permit to reconstruct existing non-conforming structurally deficient lattice-style communications tower on site. The three conditions are going to be, one, that the generator is synchronized and auto-cycled. You got it? Okay. Two, no more than 12 8-foot antennas by 16 inches. And three, if Verizon ever abandons its equipment, that they need to remove it.
I'd like to amend the second one such that it says, if it's greater than 12 antennas of this size, they have to come back to the board for approval.
Rather than no.
Right.
No more than 12. If greater.
If greater.
Are you following that? Are you?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I'll second that motion.
All right, with that, we'll go to vote. Chris, how do you vote?
Aye.
Jamie, how do you vote?
Aye.
Ben?
Aye.
Linda?
Aye.
And I so also vote for that. Now, do we want to vote for a variance? What was the variance you wanted? I want to cover the second part. What was
the increase in nonconformity to the setback?
Okay, the setback, okay. All right, we'll look at that as well. So if somebody wants to make a motion on that.
A motion we grant the variance for the increased nonconformity due to the additional height for the setback.
Okay. You have a second?
I'll second that.
Linda's second it?
Aye.
All right. Chris is aye. Jamie's aye.
Aye.
Ben? Linda? And I also.
All right. Thank you for your time.
Don't take me wrong where I'm trying to go. I apologize, but I have to protect this town against all the potentials. And as I said to you before, there are a lot of trust me's, and I don't want to use the words that happened to us. So when you go to boards and they take a position like we do, think about the other people. All right. Thank you.
All right, thank you. And what is typically the timing then of preparing the decision and filing?
They'll start the process up. We'll sign it. You get 21 days for somebody to appeal, and then we go.
Okay.
And all right. So if you want to, I know you've been in the town office here quite a few times. Pat was the one that processes it.
Okay.
She calls us the minute she has it done, and we come down and sign it as fast as we can get here.
All right. Thank you for your time, everyone.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You got minutes from the last meeting?
I don't see. We can. Do we have meetings there? Minute meetings that maybe.
perceived that might have moved that.
There's a lot of texting folks.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. There you go.
Thank you.
This was left by Pat for us. Okay, I'm gonna leave this book, these books for Pat. No, you can have it. So we're out here in file. Anybody want to make a motion with your adjourn or?
You don't have the minutes from the last meeting?
No, Ben's, we don't.
Nope.
I make a motion that we adjourn.
All right, great, fantastic.
You're here.
Aye, aye, Robert, okay. Thank you very much.
Perfect.